documented and provided in the documents for the BDA that are kept at the site. I also come back after the preliminary and I do a walkthrough. I walk through, I do the checks in the elevators. I do checks in the stairwells. I also walk around some of the other areas of the buildings. Some of the buildings I don't get to every area. It's, they're just too big and I just don't have the time to walk through everything.
And you're physically doing that yourself?
I'm physically doing that myself. The fire department, if they have an issue, they will get in touch with me and then we'll contact the building owner and address it with them. The inspections, I take radios in. I've got my own radio plus two other radios that I actually talk to myself with. If you're listening on our trunk system, you'd hear me talking to myself and you'd go, what's going on?
We do that a lot, I suppose.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So we've talked a lot about new build here. What about existing properties and is there a time frame for them to be under your regulation and are there any penalties for not being?
Existing buildings do have to comply. Typically those get called out when the fire department does a fire, an annual fire inspection within that building. They find an area that they can't communicate in. At that point they get with the building manager and direct that person to contact me and we give them the guidance documentation plus some contractor names that we're familiar with that they can get in touch with to address that. Some of the installation specifications for an existing building are a little bit different than a brand new building. Brand new buildings, we want 2-inch EMT conduit everywhere, horizontal runs and vertical. In an existing building, we recognize that you may not always be able to do that. We want you to do that wherever you can, but if it's physically impossible, we will allow free wiring of the coax. I don't like it because the chances that somebody's going to come along later and destroy that coax are pretty high. I've seen that several times in several buildings here.
So are there penalties if they don't comply?
If they don't comply, they will get a fire code violation. As to the actual monetary amounts, I'm not familiar with that. I don't handle that. I allow our fire department to take care of that, and they do a good job of it.
Thank you, Jerry. My next question is for Ray Hill. Ray, can you explain to the audience why it is so important for architects, consultants, engineering firms, and building developers to consider public safety NAS as a fourth utility?
Yeah, and actually, Gary just alluded to the fact, I made a note that, you know, your position as a recommended contractor, because 98% of the time, maybe that's the wrong number, but in many cases, most cases, what I've seen is a hodgepodge job, if at all, in an attempt to make this, these folks' radios work inside of buildings. And it's a life-critical situation. You know, public safety is everybody's problem, not just the fire departments, right? So we have to look at it that way. For me, what I try to do, and I made a note here, is to kind of boil this thing down into five steps. What I've seen, some of the other folks up here too, is a litany of horror stories about not doing it the right way. It costs the building owner a lot more money. It delays the CO, creates problems for the existing tenants if they try to get around the issue. You got to rip the ceilings back apart, back open, redo it for Gary's spec, close it back in. And far too many times in the beginning of the facility design, before the shovels go in the ground, I've seen a lot of misses on the infrastructure and the way it should look. And not just for public safety, but wireless overall is the fourth utility, right? And daggone it, if you're gonna put sprinkler systems in the building, have the same thought process for wireless in the building, whether it's the fire department radios, or whether it's cellular coverage, anything that can help, as Pete said earlier, bring you closer to the next step of making your building smarter. So the advice that I would have is to, you know, be proactive, take a look at it all up front, and plan for the next 1 to 3 years. Obviously, you want the public safety piece to work in there. You need to make sure that your architects, your consultants, your contractors, your engineers that you hire are trained up, and maybe that's an outreach that we as an industry collectively can do more of. Seen a lot of cases where, you know, they open the doors and you get the bonk and not the beep. Your phone doesn't work. They forgot about Wi-Fi. Oh, I got a funky ceiling, I got 3 inches of clearance. How am I gonna deal with that? They do free run of coax, free run of fiber. Well, that doesn't work. So for me, I would assume, if it's my money, and I'm doing a major remodel or maybe building a new building, that I'm going to assume I have a problem up front and be proactive about that assumption. If it's a lead facility, yeah, you probably do have an issue in at least part of it, right? So assume you have a problem before you put the shovel in the ground or before you start the remodel and attack it that way. And the second thing that I would do is to know your local guidelines, whether it's here in Broward, or maybe you got a building in Vegas, or maybe you got something in Des Moines, Iowa. Well, I guarantee you they're all going to be slightly different, even though they may all loosely comply with state, and states may comply with NFPA.
Right.
Third thing I would do is I partner with local competent people. There's a lot of GCs out there that do a great job of putting up buildings, and my hat's off to you guys. RF is a different animal. You can't measure it. Find people that you can partner with that you can trust, perhaps it's somebody you would recommend, that can do the job and understands what a 50 by 50 grid walk is, right? Instead of just throwing up a couple, some loose coax and some BDAs and raising the noise floor in Broward County so that nobody's systems work and they interfere with LTE and everything else from the carrier perspective, partner with local people who understand the business in the particular locality where you're in. Pete said it earlier. As the building owner, you're responsible cradle to grave. This is not a Verizon problem because it's not a cellular pass. It's part of the bowels and the infrastructure of the building. So doing it right the first time will save you money in the long term. And the last thing I would look at is making sure that whatever you do stands the test of time. B25. What about phase two? What about first thing? So what's the plans for that? Should it be an amplifier-driven system that will raise noise floor, or should it be some sort of distributed system that has its own RF source? Well, in urban jungles like Miami, New York, etc., how many amplifiers can you turn on before you start to compromise the macro site that's feeding them? Same problem that exists in public safety, exists in cellular. And in these urban jungles, we're starting to see that problem start to surface. So one size does not
help. Thank you, Ray. You know, when we look at public safety data over the years, most everything was done by actual cables, right? So the Yagyon group. For us to be able to utilize that RF source in downtown areas, Fort Lauderdale, Miami, we got to start looking at single mode fiber. How much can we do with that fiber, dark fiber that might already be here from some of the cabling companies, to really be able to scale what's trying to get done? I think the big juggernaut is that 4% of the buildings in the country that needed a DAS have the other 96 do not. And that's not even getting into public safety, right? There's so many problems with older buildings. So my next question is for John Foley. John, can you explain to the audience a little bit more about the total cost of ownership equation, what the key benefits to prioritizing public safety DAS solutions look like?
I thought I was going to get a different question.
Oh, sorry.
But that's okay. I'll take a swing
at that. Can you answer this one, too?
Total cost of ownership. So, you know, it starts with design and goes all the way through survivability through the latter stages and planning into the future. So it's not just about getting a great design and getting it installed. It's the staging of the construction. So here's an example. At the early stage pre-construction, you can put these systems in before the walls go up, before the ceiling grid goes in, and those kinds of things. You could do it at the same time as other systems are being installed. You can have a company that is knowledgeable both in public safety as well as CellBaz or other types of technologies that might be going in at the same time. And if you can look for synergies on the project side, you can save money. Also, the system, as Ray said, once it goes in, you own it. And it needs to still continue to function in the future. In the fire, in the building code and in the fire codes, it talks about alarming to make sure that if there's a problem on the system, that it's reported immediately and acted on promptly. There's some codes that give a specification that give you how much time you have before it becomes a problem that you have to notify the fire department about, that the system is no longer working. So imagine the difficulty of managing two or three or four different vendors for multiple kinds of systems and keeping multiple relationships together. So what you want is to establish a relationship with a local company that can respond quickly and understands the totality of all the systems in your building. that's the optimum. That might not be possible in every case. But if you can do that planning early, for example, we were at a construction meeting yesterday where they were talking about where they were going to run the conduit in the building. And some of those, as you know, get buried inside the duct, inside the deck, underneath concrete. Once that concrete is poured, if you have to chisel it up and put duct in again, that's way more expensive than if you got it in early on. So the total cost of ownership is going to be design, it's going to be construction and materials, and it's going to be ongoing maintenance. And those are the things that you have to factor in. Also, factor in soft costs that to you could be a hard cost, like what is the cost to you if you miss your TCO date? How much does that cost? If your project is delayed a week, a month, 2 months, a quarter, you know, a lot of times construction contracts will have bonuses for finishing early and penalties for finishing late. What is the impact of your schedule if you waited too late in the planning process to involve the public safety agencies to understand exactly what their requirements are? One of the benefits of a session like this one, and I'm so pleased that these two gentlemen came out to visit, is to start to establish these relationships early, so that when their phone rings and you're saying, remember that project we talked about that was coming up at Aventura in a couple of months, I'm that guy that talked to you, and at least they recognize your name when they're calling. And that doesn't mean that they're not going to answer the phone. That's what they do. That's their job. But I think if it's already been pre-socialized, there's value there. So there's hard costs and soft costs in the total cost of ownership. Being proactive can save time, money. And at the end of the day, what's the end goal of this? The ultimate cost would be the loss of life. So the whole purpose of this is to protect life, and then secondarily to protect property. Right? So you can't put a measure on a lost life or an injury. We got to protect against those things. Doing this correctly can save someone's life.
Just add real quick. Sorry, I was very pointing people. So TCO, well done. TCO can mean something else too. So if you the old sales question, right? If you had a magic wand, or if you had a blank whiteboard, or you know, as Covey would say, begin with the end in mind. What do you want the building to be? From a smart perspective, from a comms perspective. So look at ways to monetize those different technologies at the right time. It does. It's public safety. Sure, it is. Sure, it's public safety. But why isn't it building controls and digital signage and other IoT devices and DAS and Wi-Fi and all those things that are enablers to something that can allow you to attract, retain tenants? And while you're in the ceilings, let's pull once, enable many. The POM principle: pull once, enable many. Whenever you can, and the ceilings are open, get it done then. Over a 10-year period of time, especially if you're going to flip the property, there's value in that.
Peter has a question.
Quick question for Kevin. Kevin, what percent, I mean, how often do you see people getting ahead of this right from the beginning, or is the situation more that first the inspector gets the bonk and then that's when the building owner cares?
In Fort Lauderdale, we have a process called Development Review Committee where all projects that are going forward for permits get reviewed by this committee. I sit on that committee. One of the things that I do is I look at the project, I look at where it's physically located, what it consists of, and I make a determination if they're going to need a BDA, if I think they might need a BDA, or if I know because of their proximity to an existing radio site, they're not going to need a BDA. I make that determination and give that to the developers in writing right up front. They know immediately that they have to address this. Some of them go, yeah, okay, we got it. They'll send me back a response, yes, we understand. But they don't really understand the magnitude of the issues. One of the other things I'd like to talk about is the convergence of public safety BDA. We call them bidirectional amplifiers, or BDAs, as opposed to DAS, which is distributed antenna systems. DAS is typically used for a cellular public service communications type of entity. Both of these require authorization from the licensees. If you're going to put in a DAS network for cellular, you need the cellular company's authorization before you put it in. Some of them have very stringent and strict design requirements. You need to get those from the cellular companies. That's another reason why our BDA systems may not be compatible with what the cellular companies are looking for. They're looking for something different than what we're looking for. We're looking for reliable public safety communications. They're looking for reliable cellular communications. It's a little bit different. Yes, it's RF, but it's a little bit different. AT&T, from what I understand, wants to put in a miniature site, a mini site. They don't want you to pull signals off the air. Cost on that, I've heard, is $250,000, and they're not going to pay for it. They want you to pay for it. So you need to have those discussions with the cellular companies up front. You need to have the discussions with the public safety entities up front so that you're aware of what the requirements are for each of those entities.
Thank you. So, you know, one of the things when you look at public safety amplification, I know it's been a big issue down in South Florida, is a lot of the building owners do not understand the ramifications of not being able to move their employees in. I think everybody on the panel can tell stories about customers that call on a Friday at 4:30 saying, we got a problem, we're moving all our people in on Monday and we can't get our CO because our in-building public safety is just completely horrible. And then you start to talk to them about the fastest public safety system I've ever done in 90 days. You know, unlike, you know, service provider wireless carrier DATs, it can take 12 to 18 months based on what Gary was just sharing. You know, these license frequencies aren't something to take for granted. So, you know, you'll hear the term AHJ, authority having jurisdiction, thrown out a lot. And every time I call an AHJ, to me, and everybody on the panel can probably second this, they're very encouraged that you called them, right? We want to make sure that our first responders go into that building safely. That while we're actually, you know, sending our first responders into a building, as they're traveling to the site, especially with fire, we need to know where the fire is. If it's an active shooter situation, where is that particular shooter? We may be going into a main campus, we need to know where that individual is, but more importantly, where is that individual within the building? I know a lot of the Wi-Fi companies are putting Bluetooth beacons in their APs because that way they can try to triangulate the bad guy. So just to expand a little bit, my next question is for Trey Browder. Trey, what obstacles or challenges do the equipment manufacturers have and face in the deployment of public safety amplification, and how are those difficulties addressed?
Well, I think we face a lot of the same challenges that the building owners, the developers, GCs, system integrators face, and that's that you see periodic revisions to NFPA and IFC, so we're constantly having to stay up to date on that and making sure our equipment is compatible or adheres to those guidelines. We also see that, as we've alluded to on the panel, that there are certainly variations with various municipalities in terms of their interpretation or enforcement of those guidelines. And then they also, you know, typically will have their own additional requirements on top of that. So we're always having to stay educated on what's going on at the local level. And, you know, we do that through outreach, events such as this, where we can interact with the various stakeholders in the space. And like I said, have a mutual education on what's going on in the industry and what the needs are. There are, like I said, there are that variation and additional requirements. So what ends up happening is, from an equipment manufacturer standpoint, we have to take the most stringent of those requirements and make sure our equipment adheres to those requirements, even though it might not be required somewhere else. So we want to make sure that we've got our bases covered, no matter who we're dealing with, whether it's, you know, South Florida or it's, you know, the middle of some small town in the Midwest. The other thing that, as Gary alluded to, there's this thing called convergence, where obviously, Ray and I both work for companies that develop equipment for the wireless carriers, and there's a big push to try and have some economies of scale where you've got your other wireless systems that all reside on a converged platform, if you will. And obviously that presents issues and conflicts with public safety. So we have to be aware of that, and we have to try to mitigate that as much as possible. And once again, have mutual education amongst themselves to be able to address any concerns. And then obviously, because we are talking about systems where it's life and death that matter here. So there's a certain amount of integrity that needs to be inherent to the systems and the equipment that operate these systems. So we're having to, you know, adhere to more standards, such as NEMA 4 enclosures for equipment versus, you know, Carrier might not care about that. They may not care about battery backup. They may not care about, you know, redundancy. So these are all things we have to take into consideration and implement. So it makes it a little bit tougher, and we have to be able to, you know, address all those concerns.
Thanks, Trey. I'm going to go back to John for a question about what the path forward is for the DAS industry when we really don't have a clear standards-based, you know, like a Bixie type of way about going about all this. We've got so many buildings with issues. What are your thoughts there?
So when you say the DAS industry, are you asking about
public safety?
Public safety and building communications, okay. Because as Gary pointed out, it's not always a DAS. In fact, sometimes a fiber DAS distributed antenna system is not the best solution for public safety. The coverage requirements are different. I think it was alluded to, some of the requirements are 99% coverage, where a cell, a carrier might want 90 to 95. And the frequencies are often different. So your choices are different. And the path forward, really, it's about future-proofing. Okay, and I think we already talked about creating additional pathway. It's much more difficult to put that in and more expensive to put additional pathway in later, whether that be conduit or raceways or other things. Reserving space in the vertical shafts or risers in your building, core space. Reserving wall space. These are the kinds of things that will help you future-proof. As Ray said, you know, pull once, you know, use it later. And then the other thing is paying attention to what's going on in the regulatory arena. So more than once it's been mentioned P25, Project 25 has been around for a while. And essentially what that is, it's a move to a digital radio system that's in a different frequency spectrum than some of the older technologies that are down in the 400s. And so there's some cities that are still down 45 megahertz in the 200s and 400s and 500s. So taking all those into account is what's coming down the road. And one of the biggest things that's coming down the road is FirstNet. FirstNet is an initiative at the national level to have a national broadband network to connect or interconnect first responders across the country. It's a complicated topic. Some of it is tied up in the courts. There's an RFP that was issued with the likely winner was AT&T that was challenged by one of the contenders. It's tied up in the courts. But at the end of the day, FirstNet will be adopted. And what that's going to do is drive the conversation and the requirements across the country, where the leadership that Florida as a state is showing in getting out in front of this and doing these things first, you're going to see this start to happen more and more and more in other jurisdictions. Already mentioned was NFPA, the ICC, and the NFPA, the National Fire Protection Association. They write these, I don't know what you would call them, they're not codes unless a municipality adopts them, right? So what they are is they're recommendations that spell out how these systems ought to be designed and maintained and what requirements might be there for redundancy and so forth. And then it's up to local jurisdictions to decide whether they want to adopt those codes and enforce them or add to them or whatever. So what's down the road? What's down the road is keep coming to events like this to stay plugged in, have conversations with the local authorities having jurisdiction, find out where they're seeing this going. Pay attention to projects that succeed or fail, and by all means, keep the pressure on the equipment manufacturers to keep prices sane, and just little things like if so many of the jurisdictions are saying make sure the boxes are painted red and stenciled and have NEMA enclosures which protect them from water. Well, then the manufacturers ought to know that. But don't make me buy a box and put your box inside another box. Design your box into that box from day one. Make sure that it's easily stenciled and labeled. Make sure it's the right color. And the people that pay attention to that will be better prepared for the future.
Thank you, John. Good segue back to Gary, because one of the questions I wanted to ask if the panel could all weigh in on, I'll start with you, Mr. Ray, is you see similarities or differences in the way the code is interpreted throughout the Florida jurisdictions. I know that kind of makes it complex for some of the industries trying to do public, or some of the people trying to get involved in public safety implementation. So, you know, can you talk a little bit about why maybe different counties do different things in the interpretation of the code?
Okay. Let's take the example of Miami-Dade County. Their fire department operates on 450 megahertz, 460 megahertz, plus they also have other public safety frequencies up at 800 megahertz. So their bidirectional amplifier systems for public safety have to cover all three of those frequency bands. Here in Broward County, we're on 700 megahertz and 800 megahertz. That's all we're asking for. Our fire departments are not on the 450s and 460 frequencies anymore. The challenges are between our two counties are we have the same design goals. We want the same end effect. How we get there is different because the technologies that the end users are using are different. P25, it's not necessarily new frequencies because our old analog radio system, we just converted channels to P25 on that, but they're 800 megahertz. You can do that on any frequency band. It's just a modulation scheme, but it does have some slightly different requirements. You can't delay the signal. If you delay the signal, then the data bits don't line up when the radio hears them, and the radio will not unmute, and it will not hear anything. So there are design configurations that have to be accommodated when these new technologies come out. FirstNet is coming. That's data right now. In the future, when, I don't know, they may have voice on it. And at that point, some of the land mobile radio systems, as our public safety radio systems are known as, will go away or may go away. It just depends on what the features are available on this FirstNet network. The state of Florida is working right now to gather up the requirements from all of the end users. They're holding meetings in various areas. They just had meetings down here in Dade County. They had them in Broward County, asking the end users, the police departments, the fire departments, what do you envision this network to be used for? And it's going to have to go into the buildings. You're going to have to transfer that into the buildings as well. Right now, this FirstNet frequency range is in the 700 megahertz band, but it's slightly different than the voice range of 700. So any systems that you put in need to have the ability to be future expansion to include the data portion of FirstNet. And that's a broadband spectrum, not a narrowband spectrum. So back to the manufacturers, you need to be aware of that and take that into account in your system designs.
Yeah, that's a great point. I'm sorry, question first? Well, we haven't talked about it yet, but we've danced around the word filtering. So close your eyes for a second and picture a record album with a whole bunch of 2-minute songs on it with just a little bit between the songs, which is called dark band. You have the bleed over between all these different frequencies, right? You got the sevens and the eights and so forth. You have the cellular carriers. One of the things that it's important for an OEM to look at is the notch filtering, so that you don't have the bleed over between the songs on the record album, so that everybody can peacefully coexist, so you don't have noise, I think maybe in the 758 band, for example. But the visual is, you know, think of it as a really tight record album with a lot of songs on it, with not a lot of room in between the two. And when you select products that can help solve the problems, you want to make it right first for our first responders, but also for the carriers on the back end. You don't raise the noise floor or cause interference for either or both. So make sure you got internal notch filtering on your product so that you can solve those issues, particularly when you're dealing with multiple frequencies in an urban jungle kind of city.
So thank you, Ray. Question in the back?
Yeah, good question. Thank you. I've understood correctly from the home that operator.
Sorry, could you speak up? We can't hear you.
Sorry. I've heard that the winner of the first net will have access to this particular band, and that band can be used not only for the first net network, but obviously in offense, whatever the operator's frequencies are, they can use that for other purposes. Obviously, the first net involved extremely important in terms of bandwidth and resource utilization is a small chunk of what the operator can use. So it goes back to what you had said, this conflict of having both private networks and public safety network intermingled. How do you guys see that playing out? Let's say if it is an AT&T sure. They don't want to leave the check because it's a lot of bad there. How do you guys see that?
Very interesting question, sir. Obviously, data is data, and it's going to be intermixed on their network. What we don't know today is how much of that external non-public safety data will be on that network. And that's going to be determined by how much public safety buys into it. Currently, we're using Verizon Air cards for our mobile data. When the FirstNet system comes in, if the costs are equivalent or better, we'll move our stuff over to that, which will increase the utilization of that network. They're going to reach a point where they're not going to be able to put outside entities on it. Is that going to be right away? I don't know. I don't think so. Don't know how they're going to do that. They do have to segregate and prioritize the public safety traffic, but is it going to be on there? The non-public safety traffic? Probably.
That's a great question. Thanks for asking. You know, in choosing the eventual winner of the FirstNet, one of the things that's going to have to be considered is how do they quickly stand this network up? And that involves questions like, do we have enough towers and rooftops now? Can they use existing towers? Will it mean that they need to add new ones and so forth and so on? So the whole supply ecosystem, as well as the first responder community, are sitting back and very anxiously awaiting to see how this is going to play out. Now, if the winner is AT&T, obviously they've already got a tremendous number of towers and rooftops already across the country, and it could be that, and they've got a lot of antennas and they've got a lot of power and they've got all kinds of things that sort of form a natural platform to get a system like that up quickly. If it's going to be launched from these towers, it could mean that they need to buy a lot more. So it'll be interesting to see. So my point is that there's pros and cons to this situation. While they are adjacent frequencies, there's some advantages to having a big, widespread, already deployed network that is a platform. Another way to look at it is on the other side of it. Okay, there's a whole lot of DAS systems that have already been installed. And some of these don't have those notch filters in place for when all of a sudden something that's very close to in the 700 band that's already being amplified inside of a building, particularly trunk slammers? these are sort of wideband systems that sort of amplify everything that it can see between a frequency range and start blowing it out. If all of a sudden now that band in the 700 is critical for public safety communications, these systems are going to be causing interference in that space. And somebody's going to have to go around and root those out. And those systems are going to be turned off. So here's the point. If you're a building owner and the system is already installed and now that system that you've had in for the last 5 years is interfering with the new frequency bands on FirstNet, somebody's going to knock on your door and tell you to turn your system off, okay? And they're not going to be knocking on the door of the guy that installed it for you. They're going to be knocking on your door. Somebody's going to come and visit and say, you're causing interference in our public safety system. Turn it off. Turn it off right now. And then you're going to be left trying to figure that out. So get in front of that.
Gary wanted to add something as well.
The FCC has classified bidirectional amplifier systems for public safety in two classifications, Class A and Class B. Class A is called channelized. That's where individual radio frequency channels that the licensee is licensed on are the only frequencies that are passed through those BDAs. Channelized BDAs have their own set of issues and problems in that currently in Broward County we have over 56 channels that would have to be passed through. BDA manufacturers haven't risen to that level where they can pass all 56 channels individually. So that brings up the Class B BDA. That's where it is a broadband device that covers a specific frequency range within the public safety range to transmit all of the channels that are in that. That's typically what we have installed here in Fort Lauderdale, or Class B BDAs. just because of the complexity and the requirements that a Class A would have that they can't meet. They'd have to put in multiple BDAs in order to do that. So when they're talking about filtering, be careful what you ask for from your vendor. Class A BDA is not going to be what you want. It just doesn't have the channel capacity to handle every channel that's here in Broward County.
One of the things we're hoping that you take away from this morning is that Dense Networks, we're working with Leo Delgado's group, is really building an ecosystem to support from a public safety standpoint. Anybody in the room that's worked on carrier operator DAS knows full well. You know, we talked a little bit about 12 to 18 months. It's not an easy process. Sometimes the carrier will make a decision at the 11th hour. No, we're not going to give you the RF source, right? So I've been in DAS for 10 years, and I find public safety DAS to be very refreshing. It obviously keeps us all on our toes because the codes are constantly changing. We talked today a little bit about how the different jurisdictions are welcoming of you to approach them to try to help them solve a problem within a building. You know, one thing we have here in Florida, we've got a lot of tourism. We've got the cruise port. We've got all these different venues that could be potential threats to a safety issue. Going into an older building, you know, fire goes in and we can't communicate. That's horrible. So before we kind of look too far into the future, we obviously got a lot of buildings to solve. And that's why this session was so important this morning. I want to open it up to Q&A right now, see if there's anybody that's got any questions as to any of the content that we wound up
Do you have any way of qualification for contractors? You know, people had it put in, sure they're doing it proper. Do you have to qualify any of them, or how does that work?
Unfortunately, we're not allowed to certify or qualify contractors to do the work. I do know of some that I've seen their work in the past, and I'm comfortable with what I see. I've seen some others that I'm not comfortable with, but I'm only through the city. I'm only allowed to give out three company names. I used to give out more than that, and then we started getting complaints. Well, geez, you know, why am I not on your list? And I can't put everybody's name on the list. And then if I exclude somebody, then they get mad because I excluded them. So I have three that I'm allowed to give out. That's what I give out. Are there others out there that can do the job? Yes, there are. Are there others out there that say they can do the job but have no clue? Absolutely.
Touche.
And it's those people that I really, really cringe when I get a phone call from, because I know that they're clueless. And they can do so much damage, not just to the building owner's pocketbook, but to my time schedule. Because I have to go out and inspect these things and fail them and fail them. And I have to keep going back and going back and going back. I'm one person. I don't have a staff of two or three or four people that can go off and do these inspections. And they're just extremely time consuming. I typically set aside 2 hours per building, and sometimes that's not enough.
Harry, I have a question. We recently met with a contractor that talked about Florida state licensing requirements for electrical contractors to put these public safety systems in. And this contractor talked about an ES, electrical specialty license category under the electrical license of the state of Florida. Are you aware of the state of Florida enforcing a requirement for that kind of a license to implement these kinds of systems?
No, I'm not.
Very, very good.
Yeah, short answer is no, I'm not aware of that.
Okay.
I would love to have a specific license for BDA installations that would incorporate radio frequency knowledge, intelligence, and experience, as well as the codes as far as putting conduits in, how do you get things done. But we're not there yet.
There's a question in the back of the
phone. Eric, are you correct? You said you had three companies that you recommend in
yes.
Broward County.
If you send me an email, I can send you that.
Okay.
I don't have their names here.
Okay. And then I have a question for Trey. Are you going proactively in
Yeah, so, well, I work for a manufacturer, so we manufacture the equipment. That would be more of a system designer or implementation team that's gonna evaluate that. Certainly, the location and proximity to the macro environment, it will affect those types of requirements and, you know, how much coverage is needed or if any coverage at all is needed. As we've alluded to, I think in a majority of buildings, there is going to be some need for some supplemental coverage. To what extent, we don't know, but that's something that would have to be evaluated. You can make an assumption that there's going to be a need for 100% coverage in the early planning stages, and then as the building is constructed, then you go back and you reevaluate. But that's certainly something that these folks at Garrett can recommend. They are more adept at analyzing that and taking that into consideration.
Let me explain the process that the City of Fort Lauderdale uses. When the DRC review is accomplished, I give them a document that explains to them that we strongly recommend that they get a BDA contractor involved, one that's capable of designing, and if they need it, I can give them, you know, the company names. Have the designer come up with a conduit layout ahead of time. Have those conduits put into the building under your electrical permit. Don't put them in under a BDA permit, because that triggers a whole new level of review and requirements. Have them put the empty conduits in. When they're building the building, putting conduit in, I've been told, is peanuts compared to going back later after that building is up. After the building is up, then they need to come in with that same BDA contractor and have them do a field strength test. That's where they create a what's known as a heat map using a piece of software that currently the one that all the contractors like and I like is called IBWave. It's a very expensive piece of software that allows analysis of signal strengths to be made throughout the building, and it presents it in a colored map showing where things are, where the signal strengths are. From that, they can take and design a BDA system. At this point, the design does have to be stamped by a registered engineer and submitted for approval by Broward County first, then to our building department, where the building department will then submit it through as a permit request. It comes to me for review. I approve it or deny it, send it back to the building department, and the building department issues the permit. At that point, they're allowed to go in and put it in. From that point, once it's in, they're not allowed to turn it on until I am there and Broward County is there to do the review to make sure that nothing is coming out of that system that's going to cause immediate harm to our radio systems. After that, they're given a week or more or however much time they need. Go in, set your levels, do your fine tuning, calibrate everything, tweak it. If you need to change antennas, do what you need to do. Then I come back and do a final inspection. I only want to see your building twice. I don't want to see it 3, 4, 5 times. I don't have time, I'm sorry. Once it gets the final, then you get a certificate from me that they can give to the fire department inspector. They will then, the fire department will sign off on it, and that will unblock your CO. Without that certificate, you don't get a CO.
Yeah, one distinction I think you need to make is these codes, for the most part today, focus on new construction. So there is no building for you to go walk inside yet to do a measurement. You know, so what you're starting with is building plans, floor plans. That might be a CAD drawing, it might be a PDF. It gets fed into the IBWave software Gary was mentioning. And you tell the program what kind of materials the walls are made of and so forth and so on. So it could be that you go to this site and take a spectrum analyzer and get a relative signal strength of the donating frequencies ahead of time, so you know generally what the signal strength might be in that neighborhood. But until the walls go up, you don't really know how much is getting into the buildings, which is different than an existing building where you can go do a spectrum analysis.